Hey, RC people. I get a lot of requests about Monty Roberts. Rick, do something on Monty Roberts. Do something on... Well, all right, I'm going to do something on Monty Roberts. Now, look, this is my opinion based on the information I know. I could be wrong. I'm just going to give you my take on most all people who are out here making a lot of money doing clinics. I mean, some of them are doing a service, some of them are doing some good things, some of them aren't doing some good things. And nobody's perfect. I'm not a big fan of Monty Roberts. I'll be clear about that. Not for any personal reason. I don't think I've ever met him. You know, I met John Lines and Clinton and Pirelli and a lot of the others, but I've never met Monty. And I don't think I've ever seen him except on a couple videos that he used to have up on YouTube. But my big turn off for him is he exploits scared women, which a lot of horse trainers do. And I know I'm going to get the He-Man Woman Haters Club out after me again, but a majority of the money made in the horse world is made off of scared and fearful women. So he was selling for a while, and I can't find one thing. I searched high and low for an hour and a half, and it's totally been wiped off the web. And maybe I'm wrong and it wasn't him, but I'm like 99.9% sure. He used to sell these little helmets like this, I think is what they look like. And he would sell them for trailer loading. Now, some of these I think are medical, but he was selling some sort of horse pad for your horse when you're trailer loading. So if the horse raises his head and bumps his head while you're training him to trailer load, he won't hurt himself. And I'm pretty sure I did a video trashing him saying that was so BS. If you need a freaking helmet for your horse, then you're trailer loading the wrong way. I shouldn't be putting a horse in a trailer that needs a freaking helmet on because I'm so inept that I can't train him safely without him hurting himself. So I cracked on him, and I remember cracking on him when he was trying to sell these, and I'm like, he's just got a bunch of scared women that don't know any better, and they're like all unprotective, and if you make something pink and tell a woman it'll help save their little horsey, you'll have a million women buying it. And, you know, if you only make a buck off each one, you're making $1 million. So I remember trashing him about that, and so far it's been wiped from the web. I cannot find one picture of him demonstrating, and I remember him loading a horse with that stupid helmet on, and I was like, are you kidding me? This guy's claiming to be a horseman. He's got to protect his horse's head, and he's trying to show up. And he actually scared the horse and made him bump his head and go, see how my pad protected it? God, I remember seeing that, but I can't find it. So if you go to his website where he sells all his little tricks, you'll notice he sells a lot of buckles. I hate buckles. I'm not a buckle guy. He's a big buckle guy, things to hurt the horse and bang the horse. Look at the nice, shiny, pretty bits. We'll make it look like tiger stripes, and the women will go, ooh, that's pretty. It must be nice for my horse. Then he has what he called a giddy-up rope. Aw, isn't that nice? That's a giddy-up rope. No, it's freaking whip. You put it around your horn, you hit your horse with it. It's something you got to hit your horse with. If you're hitting your horse with something to make him move, you don't know what you're doing. But again, he sells things for people that don't know, but he gives it cute little names. I don't know. What he's got his little clips and his bands that go over a horse's nose that tighten up. And I'm just not into all these gimmicks. One of the big things I've heard, and I can't find the video or a picture of it because this guy does a pretty good job at sweeping the web on negative stuff. So he supposedly did a video that he was catching a wild horse and he was going to tame it. And there was video footage that the horse that he was catching that was supposedly running in his wild herd had horseshoes on, which kind of made him out to be a fraud and a liar because he was telling everybody he was going to work with his horse that was never touched before. And if you put any horse in the middle of a wild herd, they're going to act wild. They're going to, I put either one of my horses out there and they'll be, well, Mr. T will feel right at home. But Buddy, Mr. Playful Buddy, he'll get out there and he'll be acting wild too. And he'll run with the herd and he'll do everything the herd. And you won't even know that he's not part of the herd because he'll get out there and just react to the herd. So to put a horse out there with horseshoes on and try to fool people that I'm going to train this horse who's never been touched by human hands to show you how good I am, I kind of think that's fraud. again, there's a lot of people that don't like and they put out fake information. So I like to have pictures, and I can't find a picture of it, but that was a big scandal when it came out and he lost a lot of weight. This person says here, I personally had an action with him. He didn't do anything. I had been on the list for a month, went there with my friend's horse. He's super bad trailing. I was scared. All he did was manhandle her horse. And evidently he told this lady that he couldn't help her. And this is from a forum of Foxy, whatever. She's got a little jumper in her helmet, so I question her credibility. And in the same forum, and this just Raj says, if you look closely, he put out a book. And this is the one that I'm talking about and I've heard about. I believe it's about Shy Boy, supposedly a Mustang, but a horse actually had horseshoes on in several photos. Pretty hard for a wild, unbroke Mustang. It says Mustang. I just got my little thing a little long. For an unbroke Mustang who has shoes on, in my opinion, I've read several articles that makes him sound less than a horseman. So, like in all things, there's going to be people that hate him and like him. Here's that little head bumper that I was talking about. I think his looked different than this, but it still went over the horse's head when he was trailer loading. And here's the book that everybody talks about, Shy Boy, this supposedly wild horse that he tamed real quick. I thought there was a video of this, but maybe the video's disappeared. Now he only does the book because you don't have evidence. This website is pretty much a trash website on him. Monty Roberts lies. He kind of, a lot of horsemen you'll notice, they always kind of have a hard luck story to kind of sucker in women. Rick, why are you picking on women? I ain't picking on women. I'm just telling you the freaking truth. They give this story about a rough childhood, or I was beat, or I was sexually molested, or I had, you know, so a lot of guys that seem to be catering to women for their business usually somehow connect a hard luck story. And Monty is no different. He talks about how his dad used to abuse a horse and made him kill his bull. And he had a bull that he used to ride, and his dad made him kill it for food or what. I don't, just to be mean. He really trashes his dad, which, you know what? Maybe his dad was a jerk. I don't know. There's books out there that say his dad and parents were a nice guy and gave him everything, and he's a big liar. This website really kind of trashes. It's MontyRobertLies.com. If you want to go read all this, it's pretty much a trash site. So when somebody puts this much effort into trashing somebody, sometimes I question that too. So again, I don't know. And of course, if you go to YouTube, because they're all about censorship, or if you got a lot of money to pay them, they'll take down a video, or you can claim this and they'll take it down if they like you. If they don't like you or they like the message, you know, I guarantee you if this video was about how Monty Roberts hated rainbow flags and didn't like, you know, certain type of people, they wouldn't take it down. But for whatever reason, YouTube gets to pick and choose on what they take down, and they took down the videos that prove what a lot of people are saying, supposedly. This was one of the links on that site. You go to it, and the video doesn't play, so I question the validity of that, whether it's... It is a website. It's tv.r7.com, but the video doesn't play, so I don't know what's up with that. And the Monty Robert Lies video, .com, MontyRobertLies.com. You can click on these and read all this if you want to. There's plenty of stuff in here that's not necessarily why I made my opinion. My opinion goes to, he uses big buckles and he sells helmets for horses for trailer loading, telling people that he can trailer load your horse, but you got to put a helmet on and protect him. Buy my helmet because it protects you. And then other people start selling them too. So let's look up at this little join up. I just wanted to look, give fair example in case somebody's a Monty Roberts lover and they come here, he's just trashing him. I don't know what's true and what's not. I don't like a guy that takes advantage of people. If you're supposed to be a good horseman and you're selling freaking horsey helmets to idiots because you're telling them that they need to protect their horse to load them in a trailer, well, I think you're taking advantage of foolish people and you're just trying to make money. So I'm not a fan. Also, the horseshoe incident, when it came out, I'm like, if you're going to lie about that, what else are you lying about? And so, but does he understand a horse? Yeah. Can he make a horse? Yeah. I mean, it's not rocket science, people. What people don't understand about horses is they think it's some mystery, great thing. And what I really try to do is spread the light that it's not a mystery. It's merely learning and understanding the horse. I mean, think about it, people. Let's say you speak English and you don't speak any other language, and I put 20 people in front of you and tell you to get a job done, and they speak a different language. Let's say they all speak Spanish and you don't speak Spanish. You're trying to communicate and get them to do something. You're going to be running around. These stupid people don't listen. These ignorant people don't know what I'm talking about. They can't understand. I explained it and they don't get it. If you don't speak their language, you can't communicate with them. And calling them stupid and not getting results, it's not their fault because they don't speak your language. You can't explain it to them. And that's the same way with horses. People want to get out there and try to get a horse to do something, and they don't understand the language, and they can't communicate with the horse, and they can't talk to the horse, and they don't understand what their body language is and the mixed messages they're sending and how it's their failure, not the horse's failure. And they don't understand all that, so they fail. So they go to these fancy trainers who want to sell them a fancy belt buckle or a shiny pink halter or a shiny long rope that's with pink, and they call a nice whip a gentle stick, and they call it, you know, a carrot stick, and it's basically to hit and harass. I mean, whatever, people. You can hate me for calling people out, but I'm not making money and I'm not selling anything. So it is what it is. I'm giving you my opinion. If you don't like it, there's plenty other places to go get it. Let's look at this horsey video here, because this seems like a pretty easy horse to work with. Here we go.
Tell you that.
Okay, right here, not a fan. Tonight. I don't like yanking, and to me that's nagging and pressuring and hurting a horse. And he probably has his patented bridle that snaps on the nose that gets tight, but it's made of web, so people that use a chain are bad. But if I use web and do the same thing and yank it, it's good. You know what? It's pressure and release. He's putting pressure. I think he's putting aggressive pressure. I don't think he's giving a horse a chance to learn. He's being aggressive when he does this. And you can watch it. And if you don't think so, to me, this is aggressive. Aggressive.
I want to
yank,
tell you
yank,
that
pop.
In starting Krona tonight,
notice how
he
uses
words.
I would
like her to accept her first saddle.
A lot of people like words mean something. I don't like people that call breaking a horse, because breaking a horse is breaking their spirits and mainly manhandling them. But gentling a horse is a better word. Accepting is better than I'm going to make you do it, otherwise you're going to be sorry. So words matter, but actions have to match the words.
And rider in about 30 minutes.
It's up to her.
It's up to her.
Okay, there's a thing that people say, horse time, and it's up to the horse, and all these little fancy sayings sound good, and they mean good if people understand them. When you say something's up to the horse doesn't have a choice. If you give a horse a choice, he will just run away and ignore you and stay away from you unless you have food. If you always give that horse that choice, that's the choice. No, Rick, my horse loves me, and he comes to you because he knows you got food or because of something else. If you give him a choice between work and not work, a horse will not work. If you give a horse a choice to either flee or to stay and get manhandled or made to do something by you, he's going to choose to flee. Okay? This horse doesn't have a choice. He's locked in a pen, in a round pen, and he's got a halter on, and he's got a rope tied to him that a guy's yanking on it. That is not a horse that has choices. Okay? Now, Rick, you're just being picky. Of course you got to do that. They'll run. I just want you to understand a horse. The horse is doing things because he doesn't have a choice, because he has options, and he can choose to do it the hard way or the easy way. But the human or the trainer or the head person, the head horse, must win, or the horse will start winning. And when the horse starts winning, the other person loses, which is usually you. Or a scared woman with her pink gear that she thinks because it's pink it's going to help. Rick, why are you always picking a... Oh, be quiet, you big crybabies.
I will do it with her as a partner.
Well, that's not true.
I will not force
her. You do force
a
horse. I mean, look, you can use the fancy words and it sounds good, but this horse doesn't have an option right here. He's locked up and he's caged up. All this guy is doing is he's taking away the ability for the horse to choose the wrong response, and the human decides what's wrong, not the horse. It's not wrong for the horse. The horse's response is to run. That's the right response for a horse. We don't think that's the right response because that's not the result we want. We don't want them to run. We want them to listen to us. We want them to accept us as a leader. We want them to follow our command. We want to be able to help and control them. It's about control, and there's nothing really wonderful about control. I mean, ask a woman if she likes to be controlled. Oh, my God. If control is so great on a horse, why isn't it great when a man controls a woman? Rick, you're being sexist. You're all be quiet, you big freak cry babies. I'm trying to make a point to where the idiots can maybe connect. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So turning her loose. Is he really turning her loose? She's in a freaking round pen. The reason you put a horse in a round pen is you take away their ability to run. If a horse can release pressure from you and run away, and then you can't put pressure on it, you lose control. The horse knows, I don't have to listen to you. You can't do, kind of like a kid. If a kid knows you can't do anything to it, Rick, my kid loves me and I love it. Okay, whatever. If you want to control your kid, you better have some ability to take something away that the kid, if a kid can do anything he wants and doesn't need you whatsoever for anything, you are not going to have any control. Now, you may be able to use nice names like, well, I have influence over my child, and I have an ability to communicate effectively, whatever. Look, if Ann butts and coconuts, you can call it what you want. I just want you to understand, just because he makes it sound all sweet and nice and he's letting the horse free, the horse isn't free. He's locked in a freaking round pen. Yeah, see how nice he is? See how we're working and he's not forcing? I'm not saying that Monty is doing anything wrong. He's doing what every person that understands a horse does. You put pressure on him when you get the wrong response, and you release pressure when you get the right response. The horse is walking away. He's putting pressure, and he's going to make the horse work harder and be uncomfortable. When a horse is uncomfortable, the horse seeks comfort. They want release. Release is also a word for comfort. I don't want to be messed with. People do that. They seek comfort and release. They want to avoid conflict. They want, some people do, and they want to, you know, get away to something that's comfortable. That's all he's doing here. He's creating pressure, and the horse is getting release by moving away.
So I'm going to say,
now, see,
fine.
You hear his voice?
Corona, that's
fine,
all
Corona,
right.
That's all right. We're just, see, if you talk nice, women are like, oh, look, he's not getting aggressive. Would it matter if he did the same exact thing and said, stupid horse isn't going to turn his butt on me, I'll make it run? Would it change what he did? Would it change the response? So, yeah, you can use nice fancy words, but it's more important to really understand what's going on and don't concentrate so much on the damn words. Like I tell people with me, well, Rick, you talk about women, I can't listen to you. Well, great, then get the hell out of here. Okay, don't concentrate on the words. Concentrate on the message. The message is he put pressure and release. I don't care if he's talking nice and, Corona, that's okay. We're just going to run. And it makes you feel good. Feelings in horses usually don't go real good. You can have feelings later once you're safe, once the horse understands that you're in charge, once he understands that you're hide horse, he knows his position in the herd. Then you can have feelings and nice and love and cuddly. Look, I love my horses to death, but it's because I know I'm safe around them. I can't love something that I'm not safe. How many people loves a rapist or a robber or somebody that's got a gun pointed at them? Do you love them? No, because you don't feel safe. How about if somebody you love has a gun to protect you? Do you feel safe around them? It's not the gun. It's the person who uses it and how they have it. So, you know, it matters, people.
But don't go away a little.
Don't go away a little, Corona. Go away a lot. Notice his body, his aggressiveness of his body is not matching what he's putting out over the speaker. I don't have a problem with that. I'm not saying he's a bad, mean guy for doing that. He's communicating with his audience, and he's suckering women that think, but women are going to be so concentrated on what a nice guy is, they don't understand that he's not being nice to this horse. He's not being sweet and lovey to this horse. Even though he's talking sweet and lovey to the crowd, the horse isn't getting sweet and lovey. The horse is getting body language. The horse is getting aggressive pressure moving, strapping, popping noise. That's what the horse is getting, and the horse is reacting. Now, instead of reacting, because that sounds bad, Rick, a horse shouldn't react. I don't like when a horse reacts either unless I want it to react. But normally you want a reaction as your relationship develops with a horse. You would rather a horse respond than react. Okay? So this horse is reacting.
And about four
notice
or five
his aggressiveness.
Laps.
Notice his in popping. He is not moving his body like he's talking. And that's what I think when it confuses people is you're sending mixed signals. Because a woman will get out there and talk like him and say it doesn't work. Because they're missing his body language. It's not the same as what he's talking. And I'm not saying he has to be a jerk and be yelling, you better move, I'm going to get you. And he doesn't have to be nagging like I see a lot of people. You're a bad horsey and I'm going to make you run and you're going to, and you're not going to get any treats tonight and I'm not putting on your pink blankie. That, it doesn't matter what you say. It matters what you do.
Which direction in a round pen like this will constitute a quarter of a mile. And then after you've
noticed his body aggressive moved in, he wanted the horse to speed up. The horse was slowing down and getting comfortable. And he's like, you know what? I'm controlling your speed. I let you take a rest when I tell you to rest. So his body picks up aggressiveness. Fast run, charge. Oh my God,
negotiated
the horse went,
whoa! You're roughly quarter of a mile. I'm going to put her back in the same direction that she traveled at first.
That's now people will be like, direction. Wow, man, he made that horse turn. He moved in front of the drive line. If you watch him, he cuts this horse off.
Same direction that she traveled at after you've negotiated.
Right here, he's cutting the drive line off.
You're roughly quarter
he's
of a mile.
He's moving in front of this drive line to tell the horse to turn. Cut the drive line off, raised his hand.
Put her...
Barely see it there.
Negotiated.
Cut that drive
roughly
line off.
Quarter of a mile.
Made a block.
I'm gonna...
He was heading straight over here. The horse went, oh no, I can't go this way. He just narrowed the distance. I better turn around. But instead of explaining that, he's talking all fancy, thinking, you know what, if you buy my videos, I'll explain it. Whatever. I mean, to me, it's not rocket science, but it's because I understand it. And rocket science isn't rocket science to rocket scientists, okay? Race car driving isn't really hard to a professional because they do it all the time. Shooting a gun isn't hard or anything magical, but to somebody who's never done it, there's going to be fear, and I'm not sure, and I don't want to get hurt. And so it's the same thing with horses.
I'm going to put her back in the same direction that she traveled at first, the original direction. And let's watch her communication with me. Let's see if this inside
ear. Okay, so a lot of people always want to make it, again, make it seem so, so mysterious and so. Look, ears matter sometimes. I mean, I like having two ears. And yeah, when a horse gives you an ear when you're riding, he's listening. But horses do that naturally anyway. It's not because he's doing something magical and he knows something. Any horse, any wild horse, any horse with another horse, if you observe a horse anywhere and just look at their ears, guess what you'll see? They move around. They flick flies. They'll look at directions. They'll move when they hear a noise. They'll face the noise. They'll face pressure. They'll face away from pressure. So this horse gives an ear to the crowd and gives an ear to him. Probably been happening the whole time he's been in there. But when he points it out and everybody looks at it, it's like, oh my goodness, that's magical. Look at that. That horse did it right when he said he was going to do it. The horse does it all the time. Come on, people. It's not a big mystery.
And the outside ear will listen to the rest of the world. And there it is. Inside ear already finding me like that.
The other ear's
on
the outside
because
he sees 50 freaking predators out there and a horse is like, holy shit, what are these crazy idiots going to do? And I got this other idiot inside chasing me with a rope. And I'm just, this is just in the horse mind. The horse isn't being like, okay, I got it. He made me move softly this way. So if I give him an ear, he'll do this. And if I put one ear to the crowd, then he'll know I'm listening. And then the horse isn't thinking all that, people. The horse is doing what a horse does. A horse does only what a horse does because he's only a horse. And that's all he knows how to be.
Moving to listen to the rest of the building.
There goes that kissing and clicking. I'm not a big kiss and click unless I want it to mean something. I only click when I want my horse to pick up to a trot, and I only kiss when I want my horse to run full blast. And I do it every time, the same way every time. So when I'm on my horse, if I, my horse goes into a trot. And if I, my horse goes into a canter. And he does it because every time I do those two things, I give him body language. When I click, I want to trot, I just barely tighten my legs a little bit. And I give him a little squeeze, and he's like, oh, I'm supposed to pick up speed. So he connects the two. And when I kiss, I squeeze my horse a little bit harder and move my hips forward and give him that push with my hips. And he knows, oh, I'm supposed to run. And then after a while, all I have to do is click or kiss. And he knows what's going to happen before it happens. Why? Because he's learned through the routine that every time this happens, this is what I'm supposed to do. And every time that happens, this is what I'm supposed to do. And that's why a horse knows what's going to happen before it happens. Because he reads your body and he knows.
And that's the first gesture, generally speaking. And the second gesture is to make a smaller circle, which she just did. So there's all four gestures. Smaller circle.
It seems like they cut some stuff out here. It's a 6-minute video, but it went from trotting to walking pretty quick. Rick, that's because you missed it. Okay, I missed it. Is that a pink scarf he's wearing?
Bring the head down by the soil. Now I'm going to move in and just move her off me a little bit because I'm ready for join up.
So what he calls join up, you can call it join up. You can call it locking up. Everybody knows it. Look, when a horse locks in on you, he's basically just like, I get it, dude. This horse isn't in love with him right now. This horse doesn't say, oh, I love him because I'll follow him. This horse has figured out I'm in a freaking round pen. I can't escape this guy's pressure. He showed me that he can make me run fast and slow, and he can change my direction. He controls my feet. If you control the feet, you control the mind. The horse has learned that if I don't do what this guy tells me, my option is to run in circles and get tired, to get chased and made change directions, or if I look at him and follow him, he stops chasing me. That's really what's happening. No, Rick, he's talked to the horse with his ears and he made him believe, and now they're joined because they love and they're bonded and they have a mental capacity because he's a horse whisperer and you need to buy his videos to understand it. Well, that's because you're an idiot, because that's not what happened. But anyway.
Attention.
Nothing magical here. Any horse will do this.
Moment of join up. Stand in front of her and reward her for that.
Did you notice that reward? He grabbed her halter. Did y'all catch that? Most people won't catch that. I'm going to go back. Watch this hand that he loves and join up and giving her praise. He sneaks in a little correction, kind of like pay attention. Ready?
Stand in front
pay attention.
Of her and reward her for that.
See that?
And then.
But Rick, maybe there was a fly and you're just picking on him. These are minor things. Everything he does means something. I'm not saying what he did is wrong or bad or mean. I'm just telling you those are the little things that people miss when they wonder why their horse learns that they can lift their head and move away. It doesn't have to listen. And, you know, you're constantly communicating with that horse. And the horse will know real quick whether you know that he's screwing you over or whether you don't know. Wow, that's a miracle. Look, people, this is, I mean, you can do this to any horse. It depends on how wild the horse and how much he works and, you know, but you can do this to any horse in a relatively very quick time in a round pen. You want to impress me? Get a horse to follow you around the pasture with no food. You know, and there's people that'll do it. If you do it enough, if you do something enough, a horse will do it. A horse is like anything else. The more time you spend with it, the more it understands what you're saying, the less you have to do to communicate. You know, you've been married to somebody for 50 years. You know what your husband's going to do. He knows what you're going to do before you do it. You both have routines. You both understand people predictable, and you don't even have to talk, and you can communicate kind of what's going on. Well, it's the same thing with anything. If you spend a lot of time with a dog or a horse, you're going to develop a greater communication to where you can say more by saying less, and you kind of know what each other's going to do before you do it. Not a miracle.
A miracle? Oh, my uncle told me about saddles, too.
So he's having this nice little conversation with the horse, which I'm okay with that. He's entertaining the people, but he watch what he does. His words doesn't matter.
Say about them? He said, buck them off.
Oh, look at his ears, Rick. His ears just moved. You missed that. It moved to the crowd, and his ears are always moving, people. Okay? Don't just look at it when he tells you.
Buck him off.
Oh, look, he gave him two ears. Yep. He must understand, Rick, when a horse gives somebody two ears, that means they're listening and they love you. And he's looking at two ears because he's concerned. He's like, what the hell is this saddle? What's he doing? What's he putting on me? He wants to hear every movement and everything that's going on. So he focuses both ears on the threat. He focuses both ears on the fear. This horse is scared of what he's doing right now. Rick, two ears doesn't mean fear. It can mean fear. Notice that hand on that rope to where he keeps correcting his nose.
He said they tickle. Well, this saddle might tickle a little
bit. Okay, watch that elbow. The crowd may not see that, but he corrects the horse right here. No, Rick, he just used his elbow to send a signal. No, he corrected the horse and said, don't put your head on me. Don't get close enough to bite. That horse might nip him, and he wants his head to move away. So what does he do? He gives him the elbow. Watch the elbow when the horse comes back. He runs into the elbow. Ow. I don't want to do that. That's uncomfortable.
But
Rick, it was so nice and gentle and whatever. He still did it and people miss it. And then they wonder why. Well, I watched a video and I can do it too. No, because there's so much more that you're not seeing unless somebody's pointing it out. And hell, there's probably a lot of stuff I'm not even pointing out.
No big deal. Mr. Roberts, if that's
I don't like guys that hang on to buckles. I don't like buckles. I don't like straps on a nose that tighten up. I'm just not a fan of all that, people.
Buck it off.
So we cut a lot of room here. Suddenly the horse is strapped on both sides and is done. What happened? Well, all right, whatever. They cut it out for time. I don't know.
And then we're going to put the second billet on. Right up. So that it rides her.
Okay. Ears pinned back. The horse is feeling pressure. He tightened it up. And when a horse starts backing up, normally they're trying to release pressure. They're trying to move away from something. When they can't move away is normally when you'll get that forward, I got to run. I got to flight. I panic. So this horse dipped his ears, a little bit of pain, pressure, fear, whatever you want to call it. And he backed away. And when he figures out he can't get release of pressure by backing away, he gives a forward pressure. And it's like, ooh, here we go. Get that off of me. I don't know what's on me. It could be a lion, tiger, whatever. You notice he's not saying, oh, and the little horsey is just going to jump. And, you know, he's making it sound like it's no big deal. This horse is in a flight response right now. You really don't want a horse in a fight or flight response. Because when they get in a fight or flight response, that's when people get hurt or they get hurt. They'll go into a blind buck. They can run into a fence. They'll hurt their leg. They'll jump up and land wrong. So, I mean, look, when you put a horse on the first time, sometimes they're going to buck. Normally they buck if you go too fast. He's trying to do a demonstration and he's going fast. If he would have put the saddle on and not strapped it and taken it off, let the horse move, come back, put it on, let the horse move, come back, put it on, put the strap on, take the strap off, put it on, but that takes more time. If you take the time it takes less time. The horse is learning to buck here. Is that the end of the world? No, I mean, you can get over it and you can go around it, but this buck happened because of what he did. He caused this buck. It's not the horse, it's not the wild horse, it's not the mean horse, it's not the big, bad, uncontrollable, dangerous horse. He caused it. Because he went fast and put the saddle on when the horse wasn't ready, and now the horse is reacting to fear. He's not going to tell you that. He'll talk all nice and make it seem like, aww.
My word. Oh, Krona. What is the deal? Okay. Help.
There's a little tip here that probably a lot of people didn't know. This horse turned to him when he pulled the rope. Watch this.
Krona.
He pulled the rope. What and I'll usually pull a horse, if I got a horse bucking like that, I'll usually pull the rope to change his direction to make him look at me. The problem with that is if you let the horse get too close, he will continue to buck in a straight line and run you over. And ask me how I know that. Well, because I got knocked out by those cute little horses. I'll do a video on that one day. Those two little horses I was working for the women that wanted to keep them separated, and one of them knocked me out. But anyway, I did this exact same thing, and I did it on a shorter rope because my round pin wasn't as big as this. It was a lot smaller. And when I pulled on a rope, the horse faced me, and within a jump or two, he was on me. Next thing I know, I was woken up. I woke up on the bottom of the ground, and the horse was walking around with the saddle. So I don't know what the hell happened after he hit me, but all I know is I had a headache and I was dizzy. So the horse knocked me out because when I turned him, it happened so quick that he was just rearing and I couldn't get out of the way and he ended up hitting me, I assume. I don't even know. I have no memory of how I got to the ground and how I woke up. But you'll watch him. When he turns him, he's got distance. Watch him throw his arms up so he gets the horse's attention and says, "Don't come to me, move away." And then you'll see the horse change direction. Horse coming at him, and he's like, "Oh no, get away from me." So he kind of shoved him away so the horse didn't come in. Very quick movement. A lot of people would miss that. Pull the horse. Hey, quit bucking. Oh, don't get away from me.
What is the deal?
Oh, get away from
help.
Me.
I'm in trouble.
So what he's trying to do is he's trying to make the horse wear out and go smaller circles. And then the horse doesn't have this room to go big. Could he have let him go big? Sure, he could have. But he's on a time frame and he's trying to get the horse in here. So he shortened the rope slightly every turn and he's made the horse work harder. The smaller a circle runs, a horse runs a circle, the tougher it is on the horse. You'll see round pins with a big telephone pole right in the middle of them. And you'll see people that tie the rein to it and they'll make the horse run this little bitty circle. And I think it's kind of a cruel technique, but I've seen a lot of mainly Mexicans do it. It's a big technique for Mexican people to their style of training is pretty aggressive. The other people that are pretty aggressive is Amish people. Very, very aggressive and mean and hard on a horse. Not a fan of either of their training techniques. Not to say there's not good trainers in the Amish or Mexican, but their standard way is more abusive and hard and mean and domination on the horse. So anyway, let's get back to Monty.
Krona.
Okay, so he got him in close, and he disconnected the rope, and then he made the horse run. And now he's going to put pressure.
Good girl.
You hear him kissing, and he sounds nice? He's putting aggressive pressure. He wants the horse to run and get the bucks out. He's tiring this horse out, so when he puts a rider on it, the horse will have less energy to buck. It'll be tired of bucking. It'll realize that I've bucked, and this saddle is still on me. So bucking must not be the right answer because it didn't get rid of the pressure I was feeling. Then maybe he will buck less when he gets pressure of a person. That's what's going on.
You trying to buck it off? Yes.
So he's making a horse buck intentionally by putting pressure. Ricky's being mean. He's chasing that poor horse and throwing that mean rope. He's putting pressure to make the horse learn that even though you're feeling pressure of that, you need to realize, I control your feet, I can speed you up, I can put pressure, or I can take away pressure. Don't lose fact because you're bucking and you have something else, you still need to pay attention to me. Over time, when you do that all the time consistently, when you're on your horse and he gets scared, he's less likely to run and buck off. He learns that even when I'm scared, I still have to pay attention to you.
I want to be
it ain't
friend
nothing
again.
About being a friend. He's looking for release. If I follow you, you'll quit chasing me and throwing shit at me. So it's easier to follow you than it is for you to chase me. This ain't about friends. But Rick, friends sound so good and the horse loves him. Well, that's because you're thinking with feelings again.
I don't want to go away from you anymore. Now, this is unlike my father's method where You tie always a leg up on him,
kind of bashes his, or uses his father as why he's such a natural horse-loving guy. And maybe he does love horses. I don't know. Again, I don't know the guy.
Things to frighten him with, tie them to a fence. Typical traditional stuff. Got to break the horse. But they don't come to you, and they don't want to be your partner. They will simply
wait until you've
done enough.
You notice his ears pin when he reached for his head? You notice he stopped as soon as the horse's ears went back and went, okay, I get it. He don't like that. He didn't want to get a reaction for the horse to pull his head away. He put the link on the buckle, the pain buckle with the snaps and all the crap on the horse's face that I don't like. But watch the horse's ears pin when he reached for his head. There they go. Ah.
They will simply wait until you've done enough.
But Ricky shouldn't do that.
To completely
horse's ears
them.
Keep going back because he's still concerned about the saddle. Even though he's bucked and everything, he's keep going back there to see if he can get some clues. Because I can't see it. It's in my blind spot, but I feel it. So his ears are going back trying to, because horses figure out things with their ears, nose, and eyes and feel. You know, so I mean.
I'm doing what I love to do. And helping these wonderful animals.
So he's got what's called driving lines. Some horsemen are big drivers. I mean, I'll drive a horse sometime. Sometimes it's okay if you're trying to get a horse to be softer. I mean, there's a purpose for it, but it's just another training technique. To me, if you want a horse to ride good, ride him. I mean, you know, ride time is the best teacher. What a horse does most, they do best. So I see people round pinning, and I see people drive lining, and I see people tying, and I see people doing all kind of stuff, and they're wondering why their horse ain't a good at riding, because they're scared to ride it. Well, you know what? If you want a horse that rides good, then ride a lot. If you want a horse that round pins good, then round pin a lot.
That have been so great to me. Starting with Ginger, my first horse, and Brownie, my second horse, and on to horses
another
like Johnny
reason I don't like him,
four world championships.
If he's trying to connect with people because he's got world championship bloodlines, breeding, and all that crap, not a fan of it, never a fan of it. Breeding always equates to money and selfish breeders and sacrificing horses. That's why when you get these race horses, it's all about breeding. You get these dressage horses, it's all about breeding. When you get into breeding, it's the same way in dogs or any animals. It all comes down to money, and somewhere there's a freaking, you know, shit place where they're just breeding horses to pump out bloodlines. I'm not a fan of it.
Horses have been fantastic to me. And every time I see them misunderstood and treated harshly, I have to step up and try to help. Not blame anybody. I don't think anybody wants to be just
demonic. There's some mean people that really get off on dominating and being mean to other things that can't fight back. So, but that doesn't sell things. You know, that's why people, I'm not so popular, because I call it like it is. And some people don't like that. They'd rather me, oh, and all people are good, and pink's such a calming cover, and all you people who are buying pink things are such wonderful, great people, because you're sharing your spirit and love, and it just shows in the horse. And then I could sell a lot of shit if I ran around talk like that.
I don't think people are.
That's because you ain't been a cop.
Demons.
You don't know. I guarantee you, there are a lot of demons out there. Evil is everywhere. You just may avoid it or not see it.
But they don't understand. Learn the language equus. In 22 minutes, she has her first saddle on, her first long lines on, and making her first turns when asked by the reins. I would like it if Krona would do nothing.
Rick, why is he putting a guy on him? Why does he put a girl? Well, you know, it's a new horse and we don't want him. Hey, the guy's got a purple helmet on. Give him a break. And he's wearing a pink scarf. I think it might be red or maroon. I'll have some woman here. It's mauve. It's teal, turquoise, maroon, pinkish, whatever.
Alex would like it too. She's already proven that she can buck.
Okay, moving the feet. I always tell people the worst thing you can do on a horse is get on it and just sit. I mean, I think he probably should have got on him and got off. But he's in a hurry. He's in a crowd. And he's trying to show how fast he can do it. technically this guy should have went on and got off. The best thing you can do the first time you get on a horse is get off a horse. So the horse learns, okay, I don't have to do anything and you'll get off. So this isn't like, holy shit, you're scared, you're up there, what are you going to do now? I don't know what you're going to do. Oh my God, I'm worried. Oh no, maybe I'll just run and buck because that's what my instinct tells me to do. And then you teach a horse to buck. And if you accidentally fall off, you teach the horse, hey, when I buck, this guy gets off me. So the right answer must be to buck because that's the only way this guy gets off. I don't ever want a horse to learn that. I want a horse to learn that I will get off. I will release pressure. Anytime I put pressure, accept it because I will release it and nothing bad's going to happen. And you don't have to run and panic.
And then I'm going to put your foot in that stirrup now.
Cute little horse. But Rick, both ears are forward, so it must understand. It's nervous right now. It doesn't know where to look. He's getting pressure. Remember, this horse is getting distracted. He's getting pressure from this guy on a hand. He's getting pressure from the audience. He's getting pressure from this guy climbing on him. And when you make a horse multi-focus, he's less likely to just focus on one thing. So if this guy was out here by himself with nothing else and just climb in home, the horse would have one thing to focus on. All the fear and uncertainty this guy's climbing. So having multiple things can be good. Sometimes it can be bad. If you distract a horse too much, you might cause it to react to something fearful.
Backside now. And just give her a chance to...
Notice he's putting pressure and pulling.
You up there.
Notice this thing is around the nose and there's straps, chains.
Hey.
Notice he's keeping the horse's head bent. He's not telling people that, but the horse is less likely to be able to buck and run off when his head is bent. Also, by bending the horse, he's forcing the horse's left eye to see what's going on, which may decrease the fear.
You be nice to him now. He's a good boy. And you can just begin to sit up.
Notice
now.
He's got this hand bracing because he don't want that horse to jump in on him. So he's pulling his head to keep him turned. But the problem with pulling the head is if the horse decides to buck or jump, guess which way he's going? He's going to follow his head, which is on top of you. So he's got his hands up. These are little things that people miss and you learn from getting jumped on or knocked down over the years. But these are little things where when they try to do these techniques, they don't see all these things. And they wonder why they fail or why the horse jumps on him. I did just what Monty did and my horse jumped on me and knocked me and stomped me. Well, you probably didn't do exactly what he did or that probably wouldn't have happened.
He's a good girl. So.
Small circles. Not letting a horse have his head. Or all things that will prevent a horse from feeling like I can buck. Had he just got on him and gave his horse this head, the horse would have went, you know what? Nobody's telling me what to do. I've got my head. My instinct says I should run and buck and try to get this thing off me on my back. And he would have ran off and bucked, probably guaranteed 99% of the time. So everything has a purpose, but you don't learn those things until you've done it a few times.
And 24, we're just on 30 minutes. Accepting her first saddle and rider and walking quietly. I love this. I was right about her, Kelly.
The owner says, wow, wow.
This is wonderful stuff. Look at this quiet mare that was just out here bucking.
Well, it was bucking because he made it buck.
That saddle on.
And that's what a lot of people that do these things, you know, it's hard to show how good you are if the horse never does this. And I watched Chris Cox one time brought this horse out and he was making it buck and rear. And I was watching him and I'm like, dude, you're making this horse do. And I like Chris Cox. I think he's a pretty good guy. But he was really making this horse look like a wild horse. And the crowd was just oohing and on. And I was like, are you kidding me? He's totally making this horse do this. Most people do not see that. They saw a horse bucking and rearing and acting wild. And then in a minute, Chris had it following and doing things like this. And they were like, holy cow, look at the improvement. Well, there wasn't really improvement. And I've done videos where I make Mr. T look like a crazy horse. And then I make him look like a calm horse. So again, It's tricks. There's a lot of tricks out there. There's a lot of things that it's easy to fool people that don't know anything. I mean, it's easy for someone to appear smart if you walk in a room of kindergartners and spit out a few things that you've learned in life and suddenly they all think you're brilliant. Well, that's easy. Well, in a horse world, most people are in kindergarten. So it's very easy to walk in there if you know something about a horse and impress them that you're some sort of genius. Well, it isn't. It's just learning the horse, understanding the horse, working with pressure and release, understanding the fear, flight response, how a horse works. A horse is a prey animal. You're a predator. Don't act like a predator. Don't put the horse in fight or flight. Pressure and release, understanding the horse, talking to the horse in his own language. Anyway, hell, I'm at 50 minutes. All right, hopefully you got something out of it. This really wasn't meant to be a trash Monty video. I think anybody that gets on the internet is going to have people that hate them, and they're going to lie, and they're going to put out bad crap, and you never know what's true and what isn't. I don't know anything about Monty. I made my opinion on things that I see him do when he was selling those stupid little head protectors, telling people they needed it if they were training their horse for trail loading. I thought it was the biggest ripoff ever, and I thought it was unethical. But that's me. I made my opinion, and it is what it is. All right? Well, in that there, Buddy Miss T, you're good boys. I'm looking at them up there now. They're out there in the pasture eating.